Hello, I'm Bill O'Donnell, and welcome to another program on spirituality. Today in the studio, I'm thrilled to have as my guest the first-year diocesan rector of St. Francis Cathedral, my own parish, my own rector, Father Jerome Martinez y Alire. Welcome, Father Jerome.
Thank you very much, Bill.
Good to have you back. The reason we've asked Father to come in is because just recently at St. Francis Cathedral, the parish of St. Francis, a cathedral parish, as well as the city of Santa Fe, were honoring Father Jerome for his 25th anniversary on the 19th of March, the Feast of St. Joseph. And so we asked him to come in. Very few people could make that, even though the church was packed, and so we wanted to share some of that with the rest of the city. So again, thank you for coming out of your busy schedule.
Thanks.
Tell us, Father, for those out there who are not church-going people or don't know much about the Catholic faith, tell us what it means to be a priest and to have served these 25 years in that way.
In 25 words or less.
As long as you want.
Well, it's a great honor. I felt overwhelmed on Sunday to have so many people, so many brother priests there to celebrate with me 25 years of service to the Lord. And I was especially moved to see people from the different parishes that I've served over these many years be represented that evening. It brought back many memories about why I am a priest, and that is to serve God and to be his instrument, because in reality, Jesus is the priest, and I'm just the instrument, an imperfect instrument at that. But it's good to know that people appreciate what you do in terms of reaching out and serving them. So it was a wonderful celebration.
Yeah. For those of you at home like myself who were born and raised elsewhere, I had no way of appreciating the impact in the community. I've got to show you an example here. The roaster at this Mass, Father Frank Preto, our friend, the pastor at San Ysidro, was talking about. He showed this front page. You can look at the front page New Mexican here on this, and nobody gets this kind of coverage. But I think it said a lot. This was a great article. I want to thank the New Mexican for running this, and I think so many people appreciate it for how important it is. And I think it's partly because, as you said, you're a homie from the barrio. You grew up here. You were raised in Santa Fe and a 10th generation Santa Fean, and one of the very few, if any, previous local rectors. Was there? It must have been someone else. But
back in the 400-year history of the cathedral, I'm sure there would have been somebody local. But I was a little embarrassed, I must admit, by the coverage in the New Mexican, because I got several pages. But I think, on the other hand, it was also good PR, not just for me, but for the priesthood in general. Mm-hmm. Because over the last few years, deservedly and undeservedly, the priesthood has gotten some really bad and negative publicity mm-hmm. about the faults of a few that have really painted the rest of us with the same kind of brush. And so it was good for people to get to know what priests do by those articles. And I'm not really outstanding in that regard. The priesthood is a brotherhood. Mm-hmm. And none of us can succeed on our own. And none of us can fail on our own. We all work together. And so I take whatever honors I received on a Sunday or in the press on behalf of my other brother priests, many of whom labor quite beautifully, but in anonymity.
Yeah, it was extraordinary, and I didn't mean to, you know, blow it out of proportion. I was having fun because Father Preto had so much fun doing it. His whole vision of the Pope and naming a few cardinals in his heart and all that. I love the human side of this in addition to it, and I think it says a lot, and I know it strengthens my faith in some strange way to have been accepted so much by the local people. Just because I come to church and I've joined the family by coming to church, anybody from anywhere can come and join the family. I've noticed the difference having attended the cathedral for the last 15 years and seeing since you've been there, and you take the time to introduce people, have people that before Mass, where are you from? And the one thing about the cathedral, they're from everywhere. They're coming from everywhere because it's right downtown. It's an imposing structure that sort of is the linchpin to the just above the plaza, and people are drawn to it. And you are going and inviting them in and saying, you're welcome here.
Well, I believe the cathedral should be kind of like the heart of the city. And it has been. It's one of the oldest Christian congregations in the United States. And it should be a place where everybody feels welcome, because the building and the community mean something not just to the Catholics who worship there, but also to all Santa Feans. I mean, I don't think any Santa Fean would in a way feel unwelcome at the cathedral, because it belongs to all of us. And so I want to make people like Santa Feans feel welcome there, as well as visitors that come to our fair city, and know that this is a harbor of hope for them and a sanctuary of peace, and that they can find a little bit of God's love there for them. I've always said to the people at the cathedral, as well as any of the other parishes I've served, if loving God and serving each other can't be fun, then let's close the church down and make it into a museum. And another thing I've said over and over again is the first sermon people hear when they come into any church is not the priests, but the welcome they receive from the people around them. So I think one of the stories of Gandhi, who was very attracted to Catholicism when he was a young man in England, and went to Mass the first time, and was told that colored people were welcome in the church across town. And he never went back into a Catholic church. And so my contention is, let's make everybody feel welcome, you know, because we need everybody.
Yeah. I remember from the article in the New Mexican regarding your experience as a young person growing up as a Hispanic in a Hispanic town that had then been taken over by outsiders, and you said that you, at one point, you literally felt ashamed to be brown or to be different, and you've obviously gotten over that, but there are people out there that may, for whatever circumstances, feel uncomfortable about who they are in the world, and you've overcome that. What advice do you have for them, particularly young people who may feel insecure for whatever reason, and how to overcome that, and how can their spiritual life help them in that?
Well, unfortunately, I see among many of our Hispanic youth a desire to try and claim their culture and their roots, but by doing it in all the wrong ways, like by emphasizing the cholo mentality, you know, the machismo, the tough guy sort of look, the gangs and their associations, lowriders, all of which, I guess, you know, some of which is good and some of which is not good, but it's only the surface, you know, of our culture. And I really challenge them to do perhaps what I did, and that is touch base with their own history, with their own story, with their own culture, their language, their spirituality. And every time I've done one of my courses on New Mexico church history, for example, you can see the light bulbs going on in people's faces as they begin to realize that their culture, their history, their tradition, and their religion is a wonderful thing, something to be proud of, nothing to be ashamed of. And you can see them kind of like being reborn, you know, in the spirit, when they realize that, well, yeah, that's my background, and I have a lot to offer this society that we live in. You also mentioned something very interesting. A lot of newcomers come into Santa Fe, and I've heard it said over and over again, well, I don't feel welcome by the local people. Well, you're not going to feel welcome by the local people by not going to where they're at. And where they're at is a church, you know? If you start going, because Hispanics are so devoutly Catholic, if you start going to church, even if you're not particularly Catholic, or you start going to ecumenical events where the locals are at, it's a wonderful inn to find it, because one of the reasons that people came here to New Mexico was because of their faith. And one of the reasons they stayed here is because of their faith. So it's shot through the whole culture of being New Mexican. And if you want to know what Santa Fe is all about and its story in New Mexico, you really have to touch base with the story of the people here. And a big part of that story is their faith.
Father Jerome has described my experience. I wasn't practicing my faith when I came here. And it changed dramatically by here, because the incredible spiritual wealth of Santa Fe. And I don't care whether you're Catholic or Jewish or Muslim or Protestant, there is so much going on here from a spiritual standpoint. I think it's true, the city of most holy faith of St. Francis, nestled in the blood of Christ mountains. I mean, it's all here, and it's extraordinary. And even though the Catholic Church is the oldest church, and it was the as the Holy Father said, as you arranged for him to speak to us, flying at the, were you the moderator, the cura?
Yes.
Then when he flew over New Mexico, and it was the first time a chief of state had broadcast the people below, and it brought tears to my eyes, And I want to acknowledge you for that. I forgot to do it before. You know, people love New Mexico. And he spoke to us and said how the cradle of Christianity was here. That it was this early Spanish Franciscans crossing what's now the Rio Grande over 400 years ago that brought it, and it stayed. And we may have some colorful and not so perfect history in regards to it, but the faith has stayed and it has flourished.
Well, and that's true, and we've also been open and welcoming of other you know, Christian denominations and other non-Christian traditions. And I think that one of the things I'd like to emphasize, because there was ecumenical representation at my anniversary, is that we all have to work together. Whether we're Jewish or we're Protestant or we're Catholic or Greek Orthodox, we have to work together to face the community's problems. We can no longer be separate. We have to join hands, and we cannot do it too soon.
Yeah, and I want to acknowledge you for being a leader in the ecumenical field. And I've known how some other religions hadn't felt comfortable to come. They were never invited before, apparently, and you've done a lot to break down that through your work with the ecumenical. But I think this would be a great time to give the people at home a little look, a little taste, a few minutes of just some rough footage taken just earlier this last Sunday for Father Jerome's 25th anniversary. So if we could just see a few minutes of what happened there. It's a very touching moment when Father Jerome welcomes his father to come up, and he honors his family and those who have supported him in his 25 years, as so many families do for the priesthood. So let's take a look at this few minutes of St. Francis Cathedral honoring Father Jerome.
I certainly would not have stayed in for 25 years. My mother was, of course, in heaven. She was instrumental in my vocation with my father, and my brothers and sisters, my in-laws and outlaws, my tias and tios, all of the extended family, and seated here in the front, I want them to stand so that you can acknowledge that they come from near and far to be with me today.
Hi, welcome back. If you've just joined us, you've been seeing a few minutes of the 25th anniversary celebration at St. Francis Cathedral with the first-year rector, Father Jerome Martinez y Alire, and here he is again. How'd you like that, Father?
Oh, that was a wonderful and touching moment. That was my father and myself presenting flowers to the Virgin Mary under her title, Our Lady of Peace, and that little statue is the oldest representation of the Virgin Mary in the United States. And quite instrumental in my own vocation, because when I went to the novenas of Our Lady when I was 12 years old, and it was at those early morning masses that I first got the call to be a priest at that very tender and early age. And she's been a great symbol to our people of God's continued protection and love, even in this very harsh place to live in.
Yeah, I loved your story about the Hispanic lady who went all the time to Mass and didn't come on the Feast of St. Patrick, but then came on the Feast of St. Joseph, and what's the punchline on that?
Well, she was, of course, only coming to feast days in which there was a Hispanic saint, and the priest said, well, St. Joseph is not a Hispanic saint, but she said, well, no, but he married a good Mexican girl, Our Lady of Guadalupe.
It's great. I mean, it was so touching, you know, and I think that's one of the amazing things about the Catholic Church for me, stepping back and looking at it. There is this honoring of those who've come before, not only our family, because that was also to honor your late mother who had just passed away, but to take it to Our Lady, the Mother of Jesus, St. Joseph, the foster father, in effect, the stepfather of Jesus, not the biological father, and then all the saints that have come on. We honor these men and women who have come before us, not in some type of ancestor worship, but because of the great gifts that they manifested on behalf of the people.
Well, if we all believe that we are the body of Christ and that we are an organism, a living organism, associated with the Redeemer, then we have to believe in the communion of saints, and that is that those who have gone before us are still linked to us in some way, and that they continue to intercede for us from their place in heaven, that they're still concerned about our own salvation and our own welfare. And I certainly believe that about my mother. I know I pray to her constantly, not as if she was God, because she isn't, but just to continue to intercede and put in a good word for me, you know, before the Heavenly Father. And that's the whole concept of the veneration of the saints, such as St. Joseph or the Virgin Mary, that we're all in it together, that they are, as St. Paul says, the great cloud of witnesses cheering us on to victory.
Yeah. There's a tremendous mystical dimension that's obviously a part of, that we are aware of and we honor, not just the memory, but the spirit that goes on, the soul, that so many people take for granted or don't believe that it's really what's animating the body. I know I used to be an assistant autopsy surgeon when I was a young man, and then many a body were laid right there, and the spirit was gone. That was the difference. The soul had moved on. There was this marvelous machine that was going to decompose, but it was the soul that seemed to be animating that. And the church, in its own history and tradition, without saying it directly, is so involved with that. And I find it personally very encouraging. Can you speak a little about that, the mystical dimension of this church, this greater family, both living and gone on?
Well, every time I celebrate Mass as a priest, and that's a tremendous privilege to celebrate Mass, I feel the presence not only of the people present, but the presence of all those other many millions of people who believe and worship the same way, and those who have gone before us, you know, marked with the sign of faith. I certainly believe that we stand on the shoulders of those who have gone before us, as those who will follow us will stand on our shoulders. And so it's important to be that living link in this wonderful tradition of faith.
Yeah. So we honor you today, and we honor all the other, your fellow priests, and you're kind to refer to them. And, you know, I've got to say, you know, that's why so many people are amazed. So many people wanted to be a part of this celebration of the diocesan priests being back in the cathedral. And you were honored being the first one. And as Father, I won't embarrass you any further, as Father Frank Preto did so well that day with all the gifts that God has given you to manifest there. Can you talk a little bit about what it means to be back at the cathedral, to have it back in diocesan hands?
Well, I feel very honored, as I mentioned, having grown up in Santa Fe, a homie from the West Side Barrio. I never thought the Franciscans would ever leave the cathedral. But I am just really honored to be there. I'm a native son of Santa Fe, and I have a great love for the traditions and the customs of the cathedral, and I think I have a vision of what it could be and should be, you know. Another thing is that I believe the cathedral should be a model and example to all other parishes, you know, of the best of preaching, the best of music, the best of hospitality, and the best of art, the best of reaching out to the poor, to those who are in need, you know. It should be a light on a hill, you know, and so I'm privileged to be there. There's a lot of work to be done, and I look forward to working with all the people of Santa Fe to make the cathedral what God visions it to be. And I'd like to welcome everyone to come to the cathedral. If they don't have a spiritual home of their own, that they are welcome there, that this is their Father's house. And I'd also like to put a word in here for encouraging vocations to the priesthood. I think we need priests from all over to serve here in New Mexico, but most especially we need priests from our own people, you know, the people who have been here for the longest time. For too long in the 400-year history of New Mexico, the native people were not encouraged, you know, to give their sons to the priesthood. And now there is an encouragement, and I think we need more people who are aware of our language and our customs and our traditions and culture. So I'd like to put a plug in for that too. It's a great life. I love being a priest, and I love putting a human face on God's love for us. Yeah.
That's analogous to what Archbishop Sanchez here in the same seat some time ago to talk about it. Tell us a little about what one would have to do or how people can help other young people decide to go into religious life.
Well, to talk about it, you know, in a positive sort of way. You know, sometimes our own parents are the worst enemies of a vocation because they'll say, oh, you don't want to do that, it's too hard to be a priest. It's no harder than being married.
Yeah, I'm sure hearing a lot of confessions, you know,
yes,
what goes on.
That's right, and I've also heard it's too lonely. Some of the loneliest people I know are married. You know, so it's not a question of that. It's a question of if somebody feels the call to be a priest and they're willing to give it a shot, they should be encouraged and prayed for. Even if they don't make it, at least give it a shot.
I also saw that at one time you were the dean of formation at the seminary, and you worked with young people, and you yourself got in at a very early age. You started at age 13. Today it seems like the trend is later. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, middle-aged men and older, the late vocations? Can you talk about that and what those men need to do in terms of examining their conscience or praying and to find out if God's calling them?
Yes, I entered the seminary when I was 13, and so I spent 12 years in the seminary, and then I was 25 years as a priest. So 37 out of my 50 years I've spent in service of the church. I'm what they call the last of the lifers. They don't have lifers like that anymore. They don't allow a young man at that age to enter. And the old system was basically a feeder system. You know, you got them into high school and got them into college and went on to seminary and theology. But now they really would prefer that they come in after college and have some experience, some world experience, some life experience. And then to be in contact with their parish, you know, and to be involved in the ministry and to talk to their priest. And then after they've experienced a little bit of what it could be as ministry as a layperson, then they would be encouraged to perhaps apply for the seminary.
Okay. And I brought a couple of books here that can give you a real great start if you're interested. If you haven't read these two books, I think I speak for Father Jerome when I say they are great books to read. This, of course, the base of all of it here, the Holy Bible, and the Catechism's remarkable read. It's nothing you want to just sit down and try and go cover to cover, but actually over time you will, and you'll learn probably about 90% of what the Church stands for is in here, and it's extraordinary. There's really some wonderful things in it. So
Great resources.
I would encourage you. That's why they're here. We have props here, Father. We have props. Just in the last couple of minutes, please speak to the people directly, particularly those who don't go to church or that don't believe that, or they think organized religion is a dirty word and they're dismissing it. Tell them what they're missing.
Well, organized religion sometimes has given itself a bad reputation for being overly concerned with rules and regulations and being inhospitable to people and perhaps being overly righteous. But I think that the Catholic Church in particular has gone a great way in really reaching out to people and letting them know that religion is more than rules and regulations. It's the love of God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind, and the service of our brothers and sisters, and that there's room for everybody. And I think I can't imagine living life, even if I weren't a priest, without God at the center. Life would be psychic suicide without prayer and without a higher power and without a community of faith to support me. So if you haven't got a spiritual home, you know, come and give us a try.
Yeah, as they say in the church, come on down.
And, come on down.
I'm sure you, Father Jerome and his current associate rector, Father Jose and Father Bob, will be happy to help you. And you have a tremendous staff, too. You want to say a word about the rest of the staff there, just the last minute?
Well, we have a tremendous staff, and we also have a fabulous Catholic school.
Yes.
You know, we have 240 kids for those who would like to have a faith-based, value-based type of education. We have a great little school, and it's right downtown Santa Fe. It provides a safe environment and excellent education.
Okay, we've run out of time, unfortunately. I promised to get Father Jerome back because he has to have Mass today. I want to thank you for viewing, and if you have any questions, please feel free to call Father Jerome at the Cathedral. What's the phone number?
982-5619.
Okay, or give them a call down there, or just go on down and check it out for yourself. It's a great place to pray and meditate in the cathedral throughout the day. And so, again, thank you for coming, Father Jerome. On behalf of everybody here at Spirituality, I want to thank you for watching, and stay tuned next week at this time for another program on spirituality.